For over six decades, he's done it his way. Tonight, a very special look back at my last interview with Frank Sinatra. The music, the memories, the legend. Francis, next on Larry King Live. Frank Sinatra, on December 12th, exactly, celebrated his 82nd birthday, and we did a wonderful show with two of the daughters and granddaughter and a former wife, Mia Farrow. We thought maybe you'd like to see what Francis was like as an interview subject. This is the last major interview he did. It was in 1988 at our studios here in New York. So a reprise edition on this post-Christmas edition of Larry King Live with the chairman of the board. Watch. Why are you here? Why did you come to this program? I mean, I'm glad you came.
No, because you asked me to come, and I haven't seen you in a long time to begin with. I thought we ought to get together and chat.
Simple decision.
Talk about a lot of things. But we came to town because, obviously, for the Irving Berlin thing, which, by the way, was a big thrill and fun to do. He was a great man. I knew him for years.
Why don't you do more interviews?
Nobody invites me. I'm serious. I'm quite serious. We don't get many calls for me to sit down and chat and do it.
You don't get many calls? Do you think it's because they think you won't come?
Maybe. It's possible, you know. In some cases, I probably wouldn't do it because of either the person himself or herself or their attitude about things that maybe would rub me the wrong way. So I just stay away from that. But I like doing them. I think they're interesting. And it gives people the chance around the country, if they're interested at all, to find out what I'm doing, where I'm at, what I'm going to do.
And you also learn a lot about yourself, don't you?
Of course, too. Of course. Because a good question can open up doors in my mind that I would never think of discussing with anybody. And it's important, actually, that the interviewer does homework and gets going instead of kind of dull, you know, where we are born and so on and so forth, and how tall is your old man.
But you also have to have an element of trust, don't you?
I think so.
That the person is sincerely interested.
Yeah,
in you.
I think so. And you know, I don't mind questions that border on. Maybe a difficult way to answer, because I try to find my way out of it if I can. If I can't, then I say, I don't think I can answer your question.
There's so many things to talk about with you. And
sure.
We're going to see all right, let's start with, when we spoke on the phone last week, you were hysterical. You know, sometimes you don't know how funny you are, but you said, quote, it's okay to tell them, right?
Sure.
You said, Larry, on your show, can we say the words pimps and whores?
Right.
And since I just said it, it's obviously okay.
Mm-hmm.
What were we referring to?
Well, I did an interview not long ago about what I'm doing, my work, and so on and so forth. And we got around to discussing people who are writing kiss and tell books. That's really what started the whole thing. And I said that kiss and tell books, I have another name for people who write those kind of books, and they're pimps and whores. Because they can't write their own name to earn a living properly. They got to lean on somebody else. And they know nothing about the person of whom they've written. Really don't know. They just read newspaper clips and they write a story. And fortunately and unfortunately, but more fortunately, that we have the right to say whatever we want in our country, which I agree with. And I just feel that there's that element which brought about the title of Pimps and Whores.
Right. You told me once that people who make a living off other people's fortunes or misfortunes,
yes,
are parasites in a
sense.
Parasites. Why don't you respond to them sooner? When a book was written about you, why didn't you come out and not get? Because when the personality written about doesn't come out, isn't there an assumption?
Oh, I agree that there's probably a large assumption. But advice from family members and an attorney and so on and so forth, it turned out that we didn't take a vote, but if we had, answering that would have lost.
would have lost.
It would have lost. I mean, I wouldn't have answered it anyway, because we would have agreed, don't answer it, just be quiet about it. I hope that she had a lot of fun with the money she made by writing a lot of crap that she wrote about, which really most of it was anyway.
How about the pain, though?
It wasn't too bad.
Didn't harm you?
No, it didn't really sting me that much. I've been whacked around before and came through pretty good.
How about your kids?
The kids, I worried about my family a lot. They never said a word. They never mentioned it. We never discussed it. My friends never discussed it. They were angry. They said, you know, that so-and-so. And so I said, forget about it. In 6 months' time, nobody will ever remember what she ever wrote about. And she can't do it again. She'll never do it again.
Was it a mistake to try to stop it, by the way?
It would have been a mistake. I think so. I think it caused more notoriety if you try to stop it. Would you agree to that?
Yeah, that was a mistake you made, right?
Yeah. Well, we didn't try to stop it. What we wanted to do was to have something to say about it. You know, I don't remember now what my people were saying to her people, because that's a long time ago.
The whole reaction to this on your part is, you think, are you extending that to books like Donald Regan's book about Nancy Reagan and Nancy Reagan and Larry Speaks, these current ways?
That's correct, yeah. I'm saying those are the pimps and the whores. They're the ones who write the books about people with whom they had a kind of a privy association, and believed in them, and they believed in the other guy, and suddenly they're out making a buck because they got a pigeon.
Okay, what is, Frank, do you think, our right to know? Do we have a right to know, as a people, whether Nancy Reagan reads horoscopes? Is that our right to know?
I don't want to know. I mean, it's the only way I can answer your question. I really don't. I don't want to know about a lot of people about a lot of things that they do. I really don't want to know. I think there's a. Listen, we could talk all for the next week about how badly we feel when we read things about people, but we're never going to stop it, because it's going to go on and on.
Human nature.
Absolutely, particularly if it's a hot subject, And you talk about the first lady in this case. She's a famous lady, and they're going to take shots at it. And they take shots at the president. Everybody takes it. That's the American way. You take a shot at him.
Did you know Don Regan, though, don't you?
Yes, sure.
Are you surprised by this?
I was surprised, yes.
You know Nancy very well.
Very well.
Right. And you know her intimately. I mean, you're a close associate.
That's correct. Long time.
So give us the other side. We haven't heard that yet. There's some thinking that this family's a little kooky.
I don't know if I don't think that's the proper word to use, because I don't know how their family around their table and discuss their problems. But I do know that Nancy Reagan is a straightforward, very honest, strong lady. Very strong lady. And she's very bright, too. She's not in any sense in the dark about too many things, I would have to guess. I don't know about how much power she might hold over the president, or how often they discuss his problems. I don't know that. None of us know that. But I would say that she is she's a great help to the president. I'd have to go on and make a statement like that. I've never been present when they had a kind of a private come, but I have to believe that she's a big help to them.
You know them both a long time.
Long time.
And almost, I don't want to paraphrase you. Last time we were together on radio, you said that part of the reason you were for them was because you liked them so much, because you're a lifelong Democrat.
That's correct, yeah. I like them as people, you know. And then I got a little cold about my team there for a while. It wasn't pleasing me. I didn't like the way they were doing things when they got elected. And I began to move around a little bit. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to do, to switch from one party to another. We have the right to do that. But I believe in the president very much. I think he's a straight ahead guy. He's a clear thinking man.
Are you going to support George Bush?
Yes. Yes.
Campaign?
I don't know whether I will or not yet. I don't know, but I will.
Do you think it matters?
Him.
Do you think we're affected if Frank Sinatra supports someone?
I don't know. I don't think so. I mean, we have a right to do that, don't we?
No, but I mean, do you think you sway people?
Oh, I don't know if I sway. I may sway my family or my kids or somebody, but if it, maybe not, you know, because kids are all grown now, and they have their own opinions, too. For instance, my son Frank and I, we often discuss politics. He's a bright kid. He wants to know what's happening. And they're proud of the fact that I happen to know people who are in office, and they ask me questions about them. What is he like? And what do you talk about? And so on and so forth. But I have to guess that a great many people in America resent the fact that we, in public life, take sides like that. I think they resent it.
Saying, like, who are they?
That's, yeah. You know, why should they be trying to sway other people to vote the way they vote, you know?
So you think it can work in reverse, like Warren Beatty endorses?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I've had mail through the years about people saying, want your butt out and shut your mouth, you know, we'll choose the candidate.
Because you were always an activist.
Always.
You go back to Al Smith.
All the way back to Al Smith. My mother was always in politics, so I learned everything from her.
You still get a lot of fan mail?
Yep.
You must get tons.
Mm-hmm.
You ever read any?
Mm-hmm. My gal keeps the interesting ones for me. The ones that just, please send me a photograph, fine. Or you stink, and you say, why are you still singing? I like the other guy better, and we get all kinds of mail, which is kind of fun. Anyway. But we get fan mail from foreign countries, a lot of mail from countries like Norway, Albania, places that you'd never dreamed that they, well, of course now, with tape and recordings and whatever they have in the films, they see everything we see.
The kid from Hoboken is internationally known. Does that flip you? Does that ever flip you?
Oh, sure, sure.
I mean,
I'm delighted, you know. I'm delighted. Well, when we go, we go, Bob and I go on a vacation, let's say we go into France, and we walk and go to some shopping like this, and people stop, and in their own language, you know, I hear them talking about me. And we turn around, we smile, and they smile, and they timidly want to shake hands, and we shake hands. And it's a kick. It really is a marvelous feeling. It's wonderful. Really quite wonderful.
Is there still a lot of that little boy in you?
Yeah, sure. You never lose that. I think if I lost it, it would be all over. Everything would be over.
The chairman of the board is our guest. This is Larry King live in Washington. We'll be right back with Frank Sinatra after this.
Me too.
Larry King live is brought to you by AT&T. It's all within your reach.
Frank just asked an interesting question. Do we have to pay ASCAP if you hum?
If I do more than 8 bars, I guess we have to pay a fee.
By the way, why do you hum? You hum a lot.
I hum a lot. I hum a lot when I vocalize, because it moves up everything in the mask so that it comes forward like that. And I found that out from Pavarotti and a couple of other opera singers who said hum once in a while, and it's good for the mask. I said to Mr. Pavarotti once, whom I've gotten to know now very well. He's a marvelous man and a great artist, obviously.
Pretty good singer.
I said to him, Maestro, I said, I'm having trouble closing out a note so that it sounds, so that it's almost as thin as a butter knife. Finish it out quietly like that. I said, I have trouble doing that. What do you think I should do? He said, just to close up your mouth. That's all he said, and I fell on the floor. That was the answer for it. I thought he was going to give me a dissertation on how to let the breaths run out just normally, which is very difficult to do, by the way, if you want to diminuendo, in other words. But they do it beautifully. They have great control. He said, you're just to close up your mouth.
And he's right.
He's right. Just close your mouth. But he did it with his teeth. He went like that, you see.
Why? Which opens up a wonderful area. Why do you still sing? I ask this, we're raised in a culture that's raised in thinking about retirement, work hard all your life, get the home, move somewhere. You don't have to sing for money.
No, it's
you don't
true.
Need the no, concert money.
I don't have to work, no.
No.
But I feel that, first of all, I enjoy what I do. If I didn't, then I wouldn't be doing it. I enjoy it because it's a challenge for me also. And, you know, I'm considered an over-the-hill performer now at my age. And there's no doubt about it that I think in the industry I'm considered an over-the-hill performer. But I do it because I do the best I can when I work, and I don't work that much. I'd rather do benefits and have more fun doing that than going in. If I work, I work in Vegas or Atlantic City. That's where I work. It's the only place. I go into saloons because it's...
Oh, but you do concert tours too?
Well, I do occasionally. Carnegie Hall. Yeah, I do Carnegie Hall, but that's rare.
You think you're an over-the-hill? Do you classify yourself that way?
Oh, sure, sure. Because when you think about what's selling today, who are the people who are known by millions of people? The younger people are not any of us anymore. They know who we were and they know who we are by people discussing us. Or maybe if I did a concert somewhere, and a family took their 18-year-old daughter or son to hear you, then they get to hear you. But it depends upon what they're looking at. I mean, they're looking at the guys with the guitars and all of the noise. So that's not what we have, you know.
Yeah, but you're a legend, though. I mean, you do know that.
I don't know about legend. I mean, everybody's a legend. If everybody were really legends, we'd be nobody, no normal people in the world. Everybody would be a legend.
Yeah, but you know you've gone beyond a stretch. I mean, you're in another ballpark, Frank.
Yeah, I agree with that. And there's a very good chance that I probably should have gotten out by now. But I enjoy it.
You did quit.
Well,
you had a
I took a hiatus, really, is what I did. I took about a year and a half, and I took it easy. I was tired. My throat was tired. I was tired. And I wasn't thinking clearly enough about what I was doing, and I thought, I think I need a lot of fresh air. Just get out.
Is it still a kick when the man says, and now, ladies and gentlemen, they don't even say it, I guess, anymore. You just walk out, right?
No, they make an announcement.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen.
It's a kick.
Frank Sinatra. That's absolutely. Still a kick.
Absolutely. And the first, I swear on my mother's soul, the first 4 or 5 seconds, I tremble every time I take the step and I walk out of the wing onto the stage. Because I keep thinking to myself, I wonder if it'll be there. If when I go for the first the sounds that I have to make, will it be there? I was talking about it just the other night at Carnegie Hall at the Irving Berlin thing. I said, even just going out and looking at the audience, I was terrified for about 4 seconds, and then it goes away.
How do you explain that?
I don't know. I can't explain.
You've always had that.
Always had it.
And Harry James, when you stood up to sing with the Harry.
Every always had it all the time. Will you remember the lyrics? Is your tie right? Will you use your hands right? Will you look pleasant to
so
the audience?
So this dumb Frank doesn't care, or he's beyond it.
That's not true. If anybody describes me that way, it's the way they see me. It's not what I am. It's not what I'm doing, no.
In fact, you're a performer.
You've got to be on the ball from the minute you step out into that spotlight. You've got to know exactly what you're doing every second on that stage. Otherwise, the act goes right into the bathroom. It's all over. Good night.
Can we clear up a rumor?
Shoot.
Because since you don't respond a lot, and this has been printed a lot, so it's fair to ask it. Dean Martin, you started, you, Dean, and Sammy, and Dean left the tour, and people are printing there was a rift.
No, not true.
What happened?
Dean Martin is a man who doesn't like to work. Let me begin that way. We had one or two more stops to do in that tour we were doing. And I saw him, he looked tired backstage. It's the day before he went home. And I said to him, what's the matter with you, all right? He said, I'm tired. He said, I'd like to go home. I said, well, we're nearly finished. We're nearly almost up in that. Meantime, Sammy is a bunch of rubber bands. He's jumping around saying, you know, Jesus, can we add on to it? And I'm saying, no, we're not going to add on to it. And he finally said to me, the night he left after the performance, he told me about it. He said, I have to go home. That's all he said to me, I have to go home. I said, okay. I kissed him on the cheek, I gave him a hug, and he went home. And we didn't make any statements about it. We just kept quiet. We told the audience that Dean was not up to it. We only had a couple of more performances to do. And we kidded around about the fact that we tried to fill in for him. And then Sammy did an imitation of Dean, and we were fooling around like this. And it worked out, you know. I felt badly that he didn't finish, but you can't put a gun to his head. He just didn't want to do it.
But he went to the hospital too, didn't he?
He went into the hospital. He's had a kidney problem for like 4 years, and he'd never done anything about it. So now it's beginning to really bite him a lot. Mm. And that didn't send him home. But when he got home, he did go into the hospital, because I called him there, and I said, what are they saying? He said, well, they're going to, you know, take some blood, and they're going to do the whole test and all that stuff. And I've spoken to him since then 100 times, and he's fine. He's just taking it easy.
So you're not mad or anything? He just...
No, not at all, no. I believe he still feels badly that he didn't finish.
How are you?
I'm very well. Couldn't be better.
You had surgery.
I had a lot of surgery. They had to cut up my tummy pretty badly. I looked like a road map in my tummy.
What was wrong with Frank Sinatra?
It was an intestinal infection that began to spread throughout my entire stomach and bowel and so on and so forth. And it was a very serious operation.
Are you close to buying it?
Close to buying it. If I hadn't come back from the trip that I was on, I would have bought it. They'd have had flowers and a big band behind the casket. I'm serious.
Not Frank Sinatra. No, Frank Sinatra doesn't get it. You don't. No.
No, I'm telling you. I nearly bought it.
Pain bad?
Terrible, really terrible. I was bent over trying to sing songs. I was in Spain, we were finishing a tour, and everybody kept saying to me, including my wife, why don't we go home? Let's go to London or go to a hospital here. I said, no way am I gonna go here. We're gonna go home if I'm gonna do this. So I did, I went back, I cut the tour short. I went back and they allowed me one day while I was home to do some prep me for the thing. And I came out of it, and thank God, not a problem. Not one single problem.
Were you scared?
They just cleaned me all up. Just
were you frightened?
Oh, of course I was frightened. Because I said to our physician, the surgeon, I said, how serious is it? He said, it's serious, Frank. He said, I'm not going to tell you that it's going to move a tooth out of your mouth. He said, we have to put you together very, very carefully when we finish this morning. And it was a 7.5-hour operation, and when I came out of it, there were smiles. Everybody was smiling, and I said, I guess we won. He said, we sure did. He said, you're in great
That's
shape.
A great
he
feeling.
Said, you'll never have another problem. Never.
And working again must have been a great kick to
finish. Oh, yes, of course. Because I was having trouble breathing before I had the surgery done. I couldn't. My usual manner of breathing, which is deep, lots of breath when I need it, you know, which, of course, is a trademark and has been in my singing, the long phraseology and that stuff. I couldn't do that with the pain.
We have more segments to come. We're going to break in a moment. I want to talk about The Manchurian Candidate, which has become one of the major cult films in America. Frank Sinatra is our guest. Back after these words. This is Larry King, and we're in New York for this appearance tonight.
And the Big Apple.
The place where I was raised, and Frank was raised like across the river.
But as soon as I could get out of there, I got over here.
All right, when you're here, when you're in this city, here we are, we're like 34th, we're we're 8 blocks from the Paramount.
That's right.
8 blocks. That you think
it.
About that?
Oh, sure. When I drive by there, you know, I remember the marquee and all that. That's
Frank Sinatra, and they lined up at 9 in the morning.
And they went down to 8th Avenue and all the way around the back. Up to Broadway again.
And you did how many a day?
One Saturday, I did 11 shows. We started at 8:10 in the morning, and I finished at 2:30 the next Sunday morning. We did 11 shows.
Does it give you an affinity for this city?
Oh, absolutely. Always. Oh, yes. The first time I left to come here to be in New York City, I was maybe 16, 17 years old. Just to look around, I was here with my parents when I was younger. They take me to Macy's, to the Christmas thing, and when I was 11, 10 or 11 years old. But then when I started to jump on the ferry boat, in the days of the ferry boat, for 4 cents, and sometimes you didn't pay 4 cents. When they used to pull out, you jumped on the boat.
You snuck over on the ferry.
Yeah, you got on the ferry boat. They take the chain, put the chain across, and you used to jump on the boat. But I fell in love with this city, I guess, the first time I probably, I don't even remember what it was. I just fell in love with it.
It shows it when you sing that song, huh?
Oh, it's alive. It's got so much to it. So much to
Still
it.
Still true. Make it there, you make it anywhere?
That's right. Anywhere. If you make it here, you're a hit wherever you go. I don't care where you go. Direct from New York, so-and-so, here he comes, and you know you're a hit.
Francis Albert, what an incredible career. What an incredible screen career. We'll talk about that on Larry King Live after these words. Long time ago, 26 years ago, Richard Condon wrote a novel called The Manchurian Candidate. It was a hit book, turned into a terrific film. Richard Condon guested on my radio show a couple years ago, and I asked him, where is that film? And Richard Condon said, Frank Sinatra controls that film. I hope he lets it out, but he has not let it out. And now it is out. It's become one of the major cult films in America. In July, it'll be released on home video. We're going to show you a segment from it. You're going to see a young, vital, terrific Sinatra with the late Lawrence Harvey in a scene from an incredible movie. And then we will find out for the first time on the air why the Manchurian Candidate is back among us. But here is a scene from The Manchurian Candidate.
I've been in the Army 19 years. First time I've ever seen one of these. I've been having this nightmare. A real swinger of a nightmare, too. It has to do with all kinds of strange people.
Is it about a Russian general and some Chinese and me and the men who run the patrol?
How did you know that? How do you know?
Take your hands off me.
Please, Raymond. Tell me, how did you know?
Well, I don't really know anything about it at all.
But you just started
it's
to tell
us that. You remember Al Melvin, the corporal on the patrol?
Yes, of course.
Well, I had a letter from him a couple of weeks ago. Needless to say, I was very surprised to hear from him. You know how much the guys in the outfit hated me. Well, not as much as I hated them, of course. Well, anyway, the funny thing was, he said in his letter that I was the best friend he had in the Army. I was the best friend he had in the Army.
Wow. Why did you hold on to that film?
I don't know. I really don't know. I didn't even know that we had the right to do that until it happened. I swear to God, I didn't know.
You didn't know you owned the rights?
I didn't know that we owned the rights outright, that nobody else could touch the picture. So then that he said, well, what are you going to do? I said, I don't know what you do about it. You guys, it's your business, whether you want to release it in theaters, you want to put it on television, whatever. But I didn't know who... Whomever it was who was working for me made a pretty good deal, apparently, and I never knew about that we really owned the film.
And so in other words, when you made that film, you had no idea. So when Richard Condon told me on the radio 3-4 years ago that you owned the film, you didn't know you owned
it. I didn't know it. I didn't deal much with my business people. I rarely spent time with them, you know. They bore me out for spending too much money every time we talked.
Did you ever wonder, why is Manchurian Candidate never on television?
Yeah, I wondered about it, but I never looked into it. I never went and asked questions about it.
Retrospect, how good a film is this?
I think it's a damn good film, a fine film too, you know. And the screenplay was wonderful. He did a great job with it. And working with Larry, who was a consummate actor,
Lawrence Harvey, he died.
Yeah, he made you work up to him. When you worked with him, he just demanded it. But his attitude about performing—he was a powerful actor. He really was. Had a great inner strength he had. And when it all began. If you're interested at all, I had a phone call. I was in New York. No, I was in Miami, and I had a phone call from George Axelrod, and. John Frankenheimer.
The director.
And yeah, and they said, did you ever read a book called Manchurian Candidate? I said, I sure did. They said, would you like to make a movie of that? We'd like to play in it. I said, when do we start? I said, because that's one of the most interesting things I had ever read. And that's how we came about, and we became partners in the big. Then I found out later that most of it belonged to me. So apparently, my people must have said, well, we want this percentage, and you guys split up.
So you didn't know you had that good a deal?
I didn't know I had it, no.
Well, it's a hell of a movie. You know now it's a major cult film, and now a video in July, right?
Yes, video coming out in July, yeah. Which should be interesting to see what happens. The kids who have never seen it can watch it at home.
It's a hell of a mystery.
That's right. It is a mystery, and it took me, I think, months to figure out that we had made a mystery. Is really what it was. I kept thinking, well, it's a picture about it, that
brainwashing. It has comic overtones.
Yeah, yeah. And the direction I thought was superb. I remember an incident. I had not seen the rehearsal of it. The sequence where. The people seated, it was a New Jersey garden party with a bunch of women with hats and flower baskets. And I wasn't shooting that day, but I went over to see what was happening. And by God, this whole stage turned around and it became a bunch of the Chinese communists and everybody else. Yeah. And I really fell on the floor. I said, what a marvelous idea. And that was Frankenheimer. He's a giant. He really is a giant.
Do you enjoy film work as much?
Oh, yes. I like films.
You were a natural actor, weren't you?
I mean, I think so. I never studied, no. I never went to any of the schools or anything like that. I just felt that if you learn your words properly, like you know your name, and first of all, if you believe when you've taken a job, you obviously believe in what you're about to do, and then learn the words properly, that you're a cinch. If you have any brains at all, you should be able to do it very well.
Why?
I don't know. I thought that acting is play acting like we did when we were kids. But this was, and then but suddenly you're grown up and it's for real. And then you become immersed in what you're playing, too. I made myself think that I was really that guy on any film I did, comedy or whatever it might have been.
All right, so when you did The Detective, First Deadly Sin, which you played a detective.
Right.
You felt like a cop?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Try to think like a cop?
I thought like a cop every day. I carried a badge in my pocket, or even whether you had to show it or not, I had the gun in my hip all the time. I was a cop through the whole picture all the time. And at the time when Johnny Broderick was alive at the time, we did that, the famous detective here in New York, an old friend of mine, a wonderful man. And I used to chat with him about little idiosyncrasies that they have. And he said, I don't know. He said, I never noticed anything. I said, what did you do if you were waiting around? He said, that was the toughest part of the job, was waiting to nail somebody. And I tried to put all of those little things that he told me about, I tried to put it all together, and I don't know if I did, but...
But you began to feel like...
I was a cop.
And when you do that well, of course, I believe you're a cop.
I think so. That's my point. I want you to believe that I'm thinking that I am the cop.
That's right. Because if I say Sinatra, 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 you're not succeeding.
No. I'm not doing it. I'm not doing well at all.
And it's fun being someone else.
Of course, it's fun because you can do things that you can't do if you're yourself. You know what I mean? You're playing a cop with a badge and the authority, and yet. Try to, with it all, particularly in that kind of a role, where you must exude authority if you're going to be a good cop. I was always trying to keep a little tenderness in it somewhere, so that it was not a hangman.
Yeah. You know? You were very conscious of that.
Yes.
In singing too, aren't you?
Yes.
We'll talk about that in a minute. Frank Sinatra is our guest. Back after these words. Our guest is Frank Sinatra. We were talking during the break about his doing a Magnum P.I. this year. Tom Selleck was our guest recently and told us how much he liked working with him, how surprised he was that Frank was first there in the morning at the set. You like that?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
You like him?
Well, I like him very much, yeah. We became very close friends while we were working. And he's pleasant and works well. With another actor.
Is he a good actor?
Yes, I think he's a good actor. I don't think he gives himself every break that he should. I think he should be doing parts that people would not expect him to do. I think he'd make a great heavy, by the way. I think he'd make a brilliant heavy. I thought about it when we were working together. I thought, when we were sitting around, I thought to myself, what a heavy he would make if in a well-written piece.
You're gonna do a movie again?
I hope so. I keep waiting for somebody to give me something to read. I'd like to do. I love making films.
You don't get parts to read?
No, not many stuff.
I'm having trouble conceiving this. You don't get parts to read?
No, I don't. My daughter Tina, who now is actually working for me and with me, is a bright little girl, and she is now hunting for things for me to do. She's reading everything she can get her hands on. And if she comes up with something, I'm going to make it. We'll even finance the movie ourselves if we have to.
How about her story about you?
Well, she's on that. She's, you know, that's going to take some time. That'll be a serial, actually. I mean, she's good. I don't know if she can do that in one time. I think she's going to have to do that in sections. It's an awful lot to be done.
Who would play you?
I don't know, but I think we should put on a wonderful, well thought of hunt for a youngster of 17 or 18, and then move him up, and then use several actors, move him up. And we know that we're not going to get the same face, but I think if we do it gently, the audience will buy it. That here he is 17 years old and he's starting out with a dance band and so on and so forth, and then with James and then Tommy and then of my own and the Paramount and all that stuff. That's a lot of work, like a lot of work in that thing. It's going to be a tough job for her to put together. She's going to have a good team she'll need.
Is it kind of weird to be alive and see that happening?
Yeah, I think so. I think it'll be interesting. And also, I think it'll help a lot with my being around, just to be consulted. You know, if we were on a set watching them shoot with the actor, I could very conceivably say to you, I think that's wrong, what they're doing with this thing.
And boy, you'd be right.
And I would say to the director, can I see you a minute? Let's talk this thing a little bit.
There's a standing offer from publishers in New York. The amount is incredible. For you to write your book.
I don't think so.
You don't think there's an offer?
Yeah, but I don't think I want to do that.
Why not?
I don't know. I just never thought about it. I never thought in a positive way. Every time somebody talks to me about it, I think of the negative side. I don't want to write a book. But someday, who knows? Someday I might say, okay, get the stenographer and let's sit down and go to work.
I mean, you do agree there's a great book here.
I think it's an interesting book there. Also, there's the wonderful opportunity to straighten out a lot of junk that's been printed.
That's right.
And said. And
from you.
Yeah, from come right from me. From the horse's mouth, so to speak.
Don't you want to do that?
Yeah, I'd like to do that. I think that even for my family's sake and my friends and all the people I've known for years, I think that they would be happy with it too. It could conceivably happen. I mean, it wouldn't take long to do it. It would take a couple of months. We could do that thing like that.
Do it intensely. You know? Yeah.
Sure.
By the way, concerning that, do you get angry at the people who talk to the people who write books?
I get disappointed. I don't get angry because I figure that why waste my energy if they want to make fools of themselves. But I'm disappointed. But fortunately, I don't think that's happened in my case too many times, unless I don't know. I'm ignorant, completely ignorant of it, you know.
Did you read that book about you, by the way?
Yes. Yes. And, you know, so much of it is, it's such... it's so far out of what the actuality that it's scary when I read something.
Because it's almost
things.
All secondhand.
Yeah, secondhand and third hand, you know, and things like that. Then you stop for a minute. I mean, I do, and I say, well, somebody wanted to make a buck, so they decided they're going to write a book. So they write a book. So, you know, call me Fisher, what are they going to do?
By the way, it had no effect on your career, did it? I mean,
no,
audiences didn't drop off.
No. My mail was marvelous mail.
What did you get?
I got lots, thousands of letters saying, please don't pay any attention to it. We read it, and if you haven't read it, don't read it, and so on and so forth. Or it'll hurt you, hurt your feelings, and so on. So wonderful mail, great mail. And we answered everybody, thanked them for writing, and I promised them in each letter that I would not read the book, and I didn't. I really didn't read the book. I just skimmed through it. Skimmed things that my secretary made turn the dog ears down, and I read the things that she thought I should read, and I said, that's nothing. It's the same thing all over again.
How about when gossip columnists, they write, your marriage is in trouble, these kind of things. Normal people don't read about these kind of things.
What are you going to say about gossip columnists?
You've lived with them all your life.
All my life. They started to know my name. Ever since that time.
You've had that all your life. Is it just a question of being used to it now?
I think so. Yeah, I don't see much about it.
Read Liz Smith every day?
No. I don't read those kind of things. If it's something that my girl thinks is important enough for me to see, she'll clip it and put it in my mail in case we want to do something about it.
Other than that, you don't see
it. Refute it or say, get her on the phone and I'll tell her what the actual fact was, which I've done many times, called and said, listen, thanks for doing, but it's wrong. This is really what happened, and then they did it. And instead of making enemies, I made friends by doing that, you know?
Frank Sinatra, back after this. This hour is almost over. Fame. Oh, by the way, September 17th in Houston, the fall tour opens. Sinatra, Sammy Davis, and Liza Minnelli. You're going to fill in for somebody, you don't get a bad one.
That's a great plug. That's great.
September 17th, they start in Houston. Fame. Go for it. Let's say we're in Washington, you and I, and we go into Duke Zebra's restaurant, popular restaurant. Right. You're aware when you walk in that place at lunch, everybody recognizes you. Everybody knows you. Everybody's looking at you. What's that like to feel that? Very few people have felt that in their lives.
Well, I think it's an honor.
Are you very aware of it?
I'm aware of it, yeah, but I just, I have imaginary blinders, in a sense, you know? I mean, I look around, and if somebody smiles at me, I smile, hello, how are you, or whatever, but they might talk to me. But it's not unlike anybody else that we both know in our world. They walk into restaurants or at a theater. The only time that I felt like I was causing a problem was if I go to the theater in New York, and as you come down and get to your seat, people get up. They get up and they look around. They buzz. It's sweet. It's wonderful, you know. But you want to run and hide a little bit. Between acts, you go out and get a smoke or get a drink next door in the bar. It happens again. Then you got to walk down there again. Is what takes place. But it's a nice thing, though. The recognition is really quite nice.
Unless Frank Jr. gets married or adopts or something.
Oh, yeah, let's talk about that.
We are not going to see the continuation of the name Sinatra.
That's correct, yeah. And I've been, he's had some lovely little ladies that he's brought home for dinner from time to time. And I keep saying to him, you got to have a boy. If you don't have a boy, the family name dies right now. He said, Dad, there's plenty of time. I said, what do you mean you're getting old? What do you mean plenty of time? And I said, be sure you marry a lady who's young enough to have a baby when you do get married.
It's very important to you.
Very important. Most important to me. I don't you think that it's worthwhile that we do try to continue the family name? I would think so, you know. And the girls, of course, they can't help it. They're going to take another man's name. And Frankie is, he's a loner. He's pretty much a loner. He's had nice little ladies that I've met with him, went to dinner. Or went to Nancy, the senior cook, and we all gathered at the house. And of course, sitting around the table is hysterical because it might be a pretty little girl and we're all saying, maybe this is the one. Maybe this is the one. And the poor kid is getting hustled all the time, you know. But I don't know.
We are out of time, Francis.
We're out already?
Thank you so much.
I had a good time. I enjoyed it. Anytime. Just call me and I come running. Ask me what time, what do I wear?
Our guest has been Francis Albert Sinatra.